This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world.
Welcome back to Dreamland. I'm your monthly guest host for this program, Kelly Chase. Whitley will be back at the helm next week. Today, I have a fantastic guest lined up for you, Dr. Michael P. Masters. Mike Masters is a professor of biological anthropology at Montana Tech. He's also the author of what are widely considered to be two of the defining books on the extratempestrial hypothesis, Identified Flying Objects and the Extratempestrial Model. And last year, he also published a fiction book on the topic entitled Revelation, the Future Human Past. Regular listeners of Dreamland will recall that Mike has been on the show before. And so I wanted to take this opportunity to dive into some topics that he's maybe not spoken about before. But if you'd like to hear more about his work specifically, definitely check out his books or go back to his interview with Whitley. It's a great one if you haven't heard it. Through the course of this interview, Mike and I referred back several times to an anomalous contact experience that he had at the International UFO Conference in Arizona back in 2022. If you haven't heard that full story before and are curious to hear more of the details, I'll be dropping Mike's full talk from the Inquire Anomalous Conference this last December, where he spoke publicly about that event for the first time on my podcast, The UFO Rabbit Hole. A special thanks to J. Christopher King for making that possible. However, you definitely don't need to have heard that talk to follow along with this episode. So don't let that hold you up. It's just a fun bonus if you want to hear more. We cover a lot of ground in this conversation, so let's dive into it. Here's my conversation with Dr. Michael Masters. Well, hi, Mike. It's so great to see you. Thank you so much for joining me on Dreamland. How are you?
I'm doing good, Kelly. Thanks for having me. Nursing a broken rib at the moment, but otherwise doing pretty well.
Oh, no. It's not good.
No.
Sorry to hear that. But we'll try to keep this one not too physical.
Yeah. No, if you have me do push-ups at any point, it might be a problem, but otherwise we should be good.
Okay, great. Awesome. So yeah, I was really excited to have this interview with you. You know, you and I have gotten some chances to speak before, and obviously you've been on Dreamland before. And I really just wanted to kind of have a more free-flowing conversation with you about things that maybe you don't usually get asked about, because, you know, as someone who's had the pleasure of, you know, having a beer with you and seeing you kind of outside of, you know, regular UFO work hours, it's, I know you've got a lot more to add to the conversation. So, but yeah, for anybody who's maybe not familiar with you or hasn't heard this part of your story before, what brought you into this crazy world of UFOs?
Well, most of your listeners probably aren't aware of a guy named Whitley Strieber. he's an iconic figure who published book in, I think, 87, 86, maybe, called Communion. I'm joking, of course. It's his show and an honor to be here for the second time and with you especially. But yeah, one day, I'd gotten interested in UFOs just a bit before this, because I overheard my father talking about a UFO encounter he had shortly before I was born. But he bought Whitley Strieber's book, Communion, had it up on the living room shelf. It was facing out. I remember very vividly walking in there, looking at it, and having this sort of flash of light, this moment of just awareness or interest, intrigue. I don't really know what to call it. But I imagined at that moment an early hominin, sort of chimpanzee-looking form, a modern human, and then this archetypal gray alien, and just wondered if they could be connected, if maybe there's an evolutionary, a phylogenic relationship, as we say, where we share a common ancestor. And if we look at it through time, if they're perhaps a more evolved version of us coming back through time to visit and study their own past, just like I would as a biological anthropologist. And arguably, I mean, I kind of have this position, this career, this research program because of that moment. It became a lifelong pursuit, and I was really interested in learning more about it and just finding out if there could be a connection, obviously staying aware of confirmation bias and selection bias throughout the process. But yeah, it intrigued me enough that I started out in physics and astronomy and then switched to evolutionary anatomy, biological anthropology in my sophomore year at Ohio University.
That's so fascinating that it started for you that early. for you, I mean, so you did work, you did say that you had studied, you know, physics before, but you ended up moving to anthropology. I know that with so many people, they kind of think of this as being like truly in like the hard sciences, that we need to talk to astrophysicists and that sort of thing. But what do you think anthropologists are really able to bring to the table? And like, how does your thinking and your, you know, expertise in that realm help you approach this problem a little bit differently?
Yeah, that's a great question. And especially because anthropology is such a broad field. We're considered social sciences. What I do is more along the line of human biology, evolutionary biology, but we're also culture anthropologists and archaeologists and linguists. And so I think anthropology can contribute a lot because of that. We have people coming at it from the biological side, like myself. You also have people like Hussein Ali Agrama, Peter Skafish, who are culture anthropologists, and they're looking at a lot of the cultural things associated with this phenomenon, interpretations of it. It also gives us a pass to look at some of the things we're not supposed to talk about, like the abduction phenomenon and channeling, which is Peter's main focus for his book. I believe it's called Rough Metaphysics, about Roberts was her last name. I forget her first name, but you can't really look at that seriously without having this lens that we look through, where we want to understand everything about humans. And if humans are consistently saying that they have these experiences, that mediumship is happening, that people are channeling information from different times or places or people that have passed on, we're allowed to look at that. We're not going to get ridiculed for that because that's part of our job. So I think it in the social sciences, the humanities even, it gives us an opportunity to look at some of the more complex, nuanced, and overlooked aspects of what happens with regard to the UFO phenomenon. But then there's also more of the nuts and bolts side where I came from. I consider myself a recovering materialist because I started from all the way over in that reductionist materialist mentality, because that's how I grew up in graduate school. That's the sieve I was forced through. If you can't put a p-value to it, then why are we even talking about it? And I've since kind of evolved, gone back and forth across this spectrum, kind of that bridges the humanities and social sciences and the biological nuts and bolts, highly quantitative statistical side of things. And there's no right side to be on. It takes all of that within anthropology, but also across all of these disciplines. I think it really is going to be a multidisciplinary approach that we need. And we really do need to bring in the humanities and social sciences too. And I've seen that happening more and more. People are starting to recognize the value of that. Obviously, Dr. Jeff Krapel has been the bastion of that perspective for a long time, and he continues to be, and is really making a strong case that we need to involve everybody in this. So yeah, to your question, anthropology, I think, is poised to be able to contribute a lot because of the broad range of what we study, and we need to, because humans are complex animals. The UFO phenomenon is highly complex and may even involve human animals to some extent. So yeah, I think there's a lot of growth still to happen in this field as we continue to whittle away at the stigma and start to take this more seriously.
Was there anything that happened that kind of caused you to rethink materialism, or was it just sort of an accumulation of evidence over time? Like, what was that journey like for you?
I guess I don't know. It just sort of, I guess, felt like it happened organically, but there's always something, there's always some influence. I guess you said we were going to talk about stuff I haven't gotten to talk about before. This is certainly one of them, because I don't know if I've really reflected on that, but I guess I would argue Jeff had a lot to do with it. I started having conversations with him in maybe late 2019, 2020. And we started talking about some things in my first book that I hadn't really looked at as critically. Like, for instance, I sort of debated whether telepathy is some aspect of our consciousness or a brain-to-brain communication interface, which we've already sort of been doing. And I cite a number of cases. And then with Neuralink, we're starting to see more of that. But I concluded quietly that I think it's a consciousness thing. But he was sort of writing me as he's reading through this. He's like, "Oh, Michael, I don't know. You know, I I see why you did this, because you've got to appease the hard scientists in your field. And I'm like, that is exactly what I was doing. Yes, good observation. And then at the end, there was kind of a subtle pat on the head. Like, I see you got here. You did it subtly, but I see you arrived at this conclusion. And obviously, that made me question why he was focused on that more. I hadn't thought about consciousness a lot, but it's almost like when we go in as anthropologists and ask people questions, they start to reflect on the questions and why we asked them in ways they hadn't before. So we're kind of disrupting their society simply by being there and asking questions of them. They have to self-reflect and think about their culture and what they're doing and why they're doing it. And I think that was maybe one of those moments for me where I started to ask, well, yeah, why, what is it about consciousness that may be more a part of this than some sort of brain-to-brain communication thing? And started looking at consciousness more in the context of sort of the sender receiver antenna tuning in frequencies as opposed to the non-dual perspective, as opposed to our brains create reality and consciousness. And that just felt intuitive. And then from that point on, all of these other, like, I've had dream precognition my entire life, conscious precognition about 4 or 5 times. And so some personal experiences came into it, but honestly, it was just opening my mind and reading more and starting to get different perspectives from people like Jeff and Eckhart Tolle. And I just read another book recently that was very similar. It's hard for me to recall the titles of audiobooks for some reason, but Deepak Chopra, I think is his name, actually. So yeah, just sort of trying to expand my horizons and not be such a downer materialist.
It's interesting how so many of us come to this from sort of a materialist framework. And then we, not everyone, but a lot of us kind of inevitably get to this point where we're like, oh, this thing is actually about consciousness. And yet the thing that I've noticed in myself is that in some ways that's the hardest question to answer when people are like, well, why do you think it's about consciousness? And it's like, it's hard to point to any one thing. It's almost like you have to really dive into it deeply to, do you have any thoughts on that? Like what clues you have that this is about consciousness?
Well, I mean, it's probably the same for you and a lot of us, that it's sort of intuitive. It feels right. It doesn't just sound right, but it feels right. There's something that you can sort of sense when you pay attention to this. And obviously the telepathy thing, that I don't have, at least I'm not aware of, and don't have any memories of any moment that I could have gotten an implant or anything like that. But I've had telepathic communication with these others, whatever they are. I'm not willing to say they're future humans. They alluded to that during one of the more impactful conversations. But it was done in a way that felt almost like I was lifted out of my body. And I'm sitting with two other individuals, people just like you and me, whose brains had been sort of taken over, for lack of a better word. And they were being used to channel information through consciousness alone, able to send information. They knew everything about my life, very intimate details about my life I'd never told anybody before. They knew about my future. They knew about everybody's future, and sort of abducted me. I call it a mini abduction because it does have elements of an abduction, in order to put information in my brain for a future time. So the UFO thing may be completely separate. I don't know, but there are also a number of cases where people are given information, they're shown images, they're shown destruction, war, told to take care of the planet telepathically, like in the Aerial School case. So there might be some crossover there. I'm not willing to say there is for sure, because there was no UFO involved with my interaction. So, but at the core of it was consciousness. It was communication in the simplest form. It started out with verbal communication, turned to conscious communication, telepathy. And from that point on, it was like a shared mind. Like, I was brought into a space where I could sort of sense what so many people describe even in near-death experiences. And so maybe there's some overlap there with people that have out-of-body experiences or near-death experiences. So, you know, that's anecdotal. That's from personal experience. But after experiencing that, I couldn't put that toothpaste back in the tube. I was forced to reconsider my conceptualization of reality, which now included something I wouldn't have paid 5 minutes of my time to 5 or 6 years ago when I was a strict reductionist and not really focused on these things at all. But I was already leading up toward an awareness of these types of things. But then when it happened to me personally, it catapulted me into this new realm of questioning reality. And I almost get the sense that consciousness, whatever that realm is perhaps fundamental, and this physical reality is an emergent property of that. And then when reading all of these books, like I had mentioned some authors previously, that's been said by so many people going back hundreds, thousands of years across the world. So it just, I don't know, it's hard to really pinpoint one thing. It's just an evolution of my understanding, my thinking, combined with reading other perspectives and then also my personal experience that all kind of get mashed up into a very confusing, messy ball of thought yarn.
Yeah, I find your experience really fascinating. There's just so many aspects of it that are really interesting and is not quite something I've heard before.
Yeah, you were there the first time I talked about it publicly in New York. It was kind of a difficult thing to do. I'd only talked about it publicly on camera once, and then that was the first time in a room full of people. And it was definitely hard, but it's important. You know, if there's something people can learn from it, if I can learn from it, if we can all learn from these conversations, I think they're worth having, even if it's difficult.
Well, I really appreciated you doing that. And I told you that night, but I was really inspired by it. And it was one of the things that pushed me to kind of come forward about my own anomalous experience on my podcast, and which has been a really positive experience, by the way. But I also know how I intimately know that feeling of feeling like you're about to jump out of a plane or something right
yeah,
before you.
I heard you telling Jay that on Andy's podcast yesterday, that you were a little worried about it at first. I was too. I sat on my back porch crying for about an hour, just trying to figure out if I could do it or not. Cause I was going down to LA to interview with Jesse Michaels, and I knew he wanted to talk about it cause I told him about it a year ago, pretty soon after it happened. And I got the sense that he would want to. I just didn't know if I could. I really struggled with that. But yeah, it was cool listening to you say the same type of thing to Andy and mention that Jay kind of helped you, like, don't worry, you'll be fine. And you said he was right. And I got to tell you, it's been awesome. Like my wife and I listen to your podcast on occasion. She's a big fan, but that one just has captivated. And she's like, ask Kelly when she's coming out with parts 2 and 3. It's been too long. I mean, you explained why that had been a while, but we were in different rooms listening to it. Like we put my phone between us and we're doing different things. She wanted to go to bed. I didn't basically. But we had separate speakers and we're just like yelling at each other across the hallway about like what you're saying. And it was super cool. I'm glad you did decide to come out with it. Cause it's another data point that we definitely need. And it's a really interesting case. So kudos.
Thank you so much. Thank you. It brings me back to a question I wanted to ask, which is for me, I felt like when I started diving into ufology, that it became this kind of almost collaborative process in my research, but in a way that was like really hard. It was hard to describe, and I didn't know exactly what I was collaborating with. And I wonder if you've felt that at all, like that in some ways, like there were things that were put in front of you or like synchronicities that brought new ideas to you or new connections to you. And like if you resonate with that at all.
Yeah. And honestly, to sort of do a callback to your last question or two questions ago about what moved me away from reductionist to a more sort of I think there's a word for it actually. What's Bernardo Kastrup call it? Idealism?
Idealism.
Non-dual perspective, I guess. One of the things were all the damn synchronicities. It's like, well, this can't be by chance, you know? And in the first few times, depending on how materialistic your perspective is, I guess the first maybe 10, 15, 20 times, you're like, whoa, crazy coincidence. And then you eventually realize that this is for a reason and you can start using it. What Jeff Trapel calls literary angels. I don't know if that's original material or if he got that from somewhere else, but I was having those constantly when I was writing my second book and my third one to some extent. But that one was fiction, so it was a different kind of literary angel. But I would just go to the bookshelf, pull out a book, open it to the exact page I needed for the exact thing I was looking for. And it's not some special skill or power I have. I just started trusting that process and doing it. It didn't happen every time, but usually if I just sort of let go and ask the universe, hey, where is this thing I'm looking for? Boom, there it is. And you always hear those stories about a book kind of falling off the shelf and someone just randomly opens it. It's that kind of thing, but more of a utilitarian type of relationship with it, where I started using it. Something Whitley and I have been talking about recently that I actually learned, it's another kind of full circle moment, I guess, maybe a synchronicity. I had been, since my experience in Phoenix, and maybe you can put in the show notes that conversation with Jesse, or if you guys ever published the...
Absolutely.
Or if Jay and James ever published their New York City Enquirer Anomalous talk, people could look that up so I don't have to tell the whole story here. But after that, I started waking up between 3 and 5 in the morning, every single morning. And it was painful because I got to get the kids up. I got to get them to school. I got to go to work. I got to teach in the morning and do all of my university type things. And I was exhausted. And then, 3 or 4 months ago, you could probably tell me better. I heard Whitley on your Rabbit Hole podcast talking about something called Brahma Muhurta, where it's this, again, something that's been experienced by and designated by people, I believe, in India, going back thousands of years, where you wake up something like an hour and 46 minutes before sunrise. And that's why it would always change. And I never realized that. In the winter, it would happen later. In the summer, it happens earlier because the sun comes up earlier in the morning. But it turns out this Brahma Muhurta thing, you sort of enter into almost a kind of mediumship relationship with information, with kind of this higher consciousness type thing. I think Whitley said this is where he was first interacting with these beings that singled him out, because I guess part of it is not many people in your area geographically are up at that time. So you sort of ping in a different way if you're using it. Like, he meditates. And I remember him saying that at the opening of the archives conference at Rice, where he gets up every morning around 3 and meditates. I'm like, well, that's insane. Like, why would you ever do that? You should be sleeping, my friend. Like, sleep's important. But then it started happening to me. I put all these pieces together. I'm like, wait, I can use this? And so I started meditating when I wake up too. And it's crazy. Like, you can tap in to this infinite energy source. And so instead of waking up tired and grumpy and taking it out on my poor children and my loving wife, I started to wake up energized and excited for the day. And I could bring that into my lectures in my classroom. And a new book came from it. I think he said in this conversation recently that his last 4 or 5 books came through that time, through this meditation process. And I had one pop through about a month and a half ago. I woke up, I was like, wow, where did that come from? Wrote down a little bit, went into work the next day and just typed out the entire outline for the book, something like 3 pages, single spaced, with all these reference ideas and different places I could maybe go with it, what I call biblio hopping. I go to this place to find out something about where to go next. And it came through that time. It came through that moment. So yeah, there's a lot of synchronicities in that too. But I don't think I would even be open to them unless I had already started challenging a lot of other ideas I had that I thought were concrete and the only thing we should be focusing on. But through a lot of these synchronicities and coincidences, and like you said, meeting people, you meet the right people at the right time to carry you in a specific direction that you didn't know you were supposed to go in. And then you get there and you're like, oh yeah, you can look back your whole world line throughout your life and see all of those connections and how they kind of led you down a certain path that you were supposed to be on the whole time. It's really amazing when you step back and look at it. Something, as complex as free will and determinism, becomes a question there. And I'm not willing to have that debate because I'd get enough hate mail from the mummy thing already. But there's definitely, if you look back on it, despite how it looks looking to the future with all of these potential realities and possibilities, when you look back, there's only one. There's one path. There's one history to your life. And you can see those connections. Were they there the whole time? And it just took you moving past those moments to be able to see those connections? Or did you create them? That gets into a whole nother conversation. But yeah, they do happen a lot. And they've been really informative.
Well, that's a wonderful place for us to take a quick commercial break. And we'll be right back. Hi, everyone. This is Kelly Chase. I'm Dreamland's new monthly guest host. You can catch me here on the last Friday of every month. If you're interested in checking out my other work, you can find that on my podcast, The UFO Rabbit Hole. On that show, I share my own personal research with deep dives into everything from historical cases to philosophical frameworks, as well as in-depth interviews with top thinkers in the field, like Jeffrey Kripal, Diana Walsh-Pasulka, Bernardo Kastrup, James Madden, and of course, Dreamland's own Whitley Strieber. You can find The UFO Rabbit Hole on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, YouTube, or wherever else you listen to podcasts. Just search for The UFO Rabbit Hole. And if you like what you hear and you want to go even further down the rabbit hole with me, I'd like to invite you to join my Patreon community. Patrons get perks like early access to new content and ad-free episodes. I host twice monthly patron-only Zoom calls where you can ask me questions, share your own thoughts, and connect with others. We also have a lively and active private Discord server where members host book clubs, happy hours, and just share their thoughts on all things anomalous without all the drama that's all too common on social media. It's a warm, open-minded, and vibrant community, and we'd love to have you join us. Memberships start at just $5 a month. You can sign up at patreon.com/UFO rabbit hole. That's patreon.com/UFO rabbit hole.
Who are they? Why are they here? What do they want with us? Why is it all so secret? All of these questions are explored in my new book, Them, in an entirely new way. What do Close Encounter reports tell us about what the visitors want with us? What is the military's experience? And can our memories be trusted? Can anything be trusted? Them answers all of these questions in a totally new way. It's available in hardcover, soft cover, as a Kindle, and as an audiobook, read by me. Get Them today, and you can get it from the unknowncountry.com store, signed by me.
You know, that's something that our mutual friend, who I had on the show last month, Darren King, has talked about a lot from the experiencer perspective, especially in that sometimes it feels like some of these events happen and then they kind of unfurl, not just forwards in your life, but kind of backwards also. And there's almost sometimes this sense of retrocausality that, you know, something that's happening now is somehow changing something in the past or activating something in your past. Like, is that a sense that you've had as you kind of moved along this path?
Yeah, I think so. I feel like they're kind of hard to separate. And especially if all moments in time, if we take the block universe model, if they all exist holistically as one entity, as one sort of collective present, I've always, again, when I wrote my first book as more of a materialist, I looked at these things as static, unchanging. But largely through conversations with my wife, who's much smarter than me, started to wonder, well, could they be somewhat malleable? And then I got into Eric Warko's work with his books on the long self and precognition. And he makes a strong case that the future can shape the past. And it clearly has for me in the instance I started this conversation with, or your first question, I guess, about that moment where I saw Whitley's book, I feel like that was a moment of conscious precognition, because I've had about four or five other ones and recognized a lot of those same characteristics in it. Or it could be something completely different. I don't know. I guess it's hard to say, because we don't know what time is. We don't know how it works. We know we can measure it, but we don't even know what that means. We know it's emergent, but we don't know what's fundamental that it emerges from. So it's really hard to even conceptualize the way the future might influence the past. There's been a growing consensus that it is possible. Not that we need physicists to validate things for us, because they have no idea what's going on either. But there aren't things that, even in the way we understand classical physics, quantum physics, there's nothing that violates anything or creates a massive problem. So if it is possible, it probably is happening all the time. And especially if consciousness is timeless, there you might have the ability to really influence things in different ways, where you don't have to go back into the past and meet your 8-year-old self and give them a book and say, hey, this is really important, focus on this. It might be happening all the time in a more intuitive way, with these synchronicities, in a retrocausality type of way, simply through whatever it is about our conscious antenna that's making decisions or leading us one way or another, or causing us to focus on this thing more than this thing. So yeah, I definitely think that's an aspect of it. And maybe the whole thing, I don't know, but yeah, I like that perspective. I think Jay and I have talked about that too. One other thing, just real quick, in Eric Berger's first book, Time Loops, he talks about how photons might be doing that too, that they, because everything's relative to light, it's the speed limit of the universe. It's what everything in physical reality, at least, is based on. But the photon doesn't perceive time. All time is based on it, but it's everywhere all the time forever. And he makes a strong case that that might be happening even with the thing that we use as the speed limit of the universe, that it knows where it's going. And this helps explain the double slit experiment and the Gedanken experiment, where it's making decisions based on where it ends up. And it's so hard for us to think about that, because we have a very linear way of looking at time, that the past creates a future cause. But for a photon that's timeless, it doesn't matter. It can absolutely be making a decision about what it's doing if it knows that it's going to enter your eyeball from 65 million years away when it leaves a quasar or something. Like, it doesn't matter for that beam of light. And so if everything we do and think and say is based on that, but it's timeless, then really what is time for any of us? And if it's using the future to influence the past, why can't everything else that's governed by it?
Yeah, no, that's, I really find that perspective fascinating. And I love that book. I find I'm always so challenged by talk about time. You know, I can read about it and listen to people speak about it and get my mind blown and enjoy myself. But I find that whenever I try to say something intelligent or coherent about time, it kind of falls apart. It's for me, it really is one of the hardest ideas to wrap your head around, which is why I get so frustrated when people who have, you know, just kind of a really casual understanding of all of these things will make these like declarations like, well, time travel just isn't possible. And it's like, how you can't possibly know that.
Yeah, I hear that all the time. It actually, one of my favorite cases of that happening, it was my very first big talk. I was met with massive resistance in a small talk I gave in Portland, Oregon. It's my very first in 2019, like a day or two after Stan Friedman died, I think it was. And yeah, and then I went to the Big MUFON conference. I was invited to their 50th annual symposium. I was on this panel with a bunch of great people, but to my left was this really angry guy. And I just introduced myself, said, you know, a short little thing about what I do. Had to pass the mic down because I was at the end. He goes, time travel is impossible. Michio Kaku said so. And set the microphone two people down, the one we were sharing, so I couldn't even respond to that. He was trying to just shut me completely up And then for the rest of the panel, not be able to say anything because the microphone was now three people down. And at one point, I kind of threw him an elbow and reached across and grabbed it. I was like, oh, hell no, dude. Like, this isn't how this is going to work. But yeah, it's funny. And I feel like it's gotten better because people have started to understand that we don't know what it is. You can't make blanket statements like that. And on the other side, I don't make blanket statements about how much it is possible. Or yes, this is definitely future humans, because I can't do that either for the same reasons. But it is important to have a conversation about it. And I do cite some papers, massive literature reviews, Ehrman et al., 2005, I think. They had two papers, but one of them is 2005, where they looked at everything that's ever been written about time travel and concluded that there is nothing in the laws of physics as we know them that prohibit it. And if that's the case, given human ingenuity over the last 3 million years since we invented stone tools and had this descent with modification of increasing complexity of our toolkit, we're going to figure out how to do it. And as I've argued many times, it may have something to do with our quest for interstellar travel too, because of the time dilation problem. When you go home, you don't want to just go home to your planet. You want to go home to your time. And in order to do that, because of time dilation and the twins paradox, you would have to travel back in time as well. So it's very possible that the two may be developed in concert simply because they have to be.
It's so interesting how the human mind kind of convinces itself that it knows more than it does. And like, it's something that I actually have a lot of empathy for, because I think it's something that I've seen in myself over time. And, you know, even to use an example, like, it sounds like you and I have kind of a shared experience in that, you know, I was also a strict materialist. It sounds like you were as well. And, but it sounds like, but we both had experiences prior to that, that like a precognitive dream, you know, or, you know, a sighting of some kind that might indicate that like materialism wasn't all there was to the story. And yet I just shut all of that out. I mean, I knew that I'd seen a UFO. I knew that I'd lived in a house that was like effectively haunted and that weird things happened there that none of us could explain. And I definitely had precognitive dreams and knew people in my family who had as well. And all of those things I experienced, and yet that you just kind of like tie it up and shove it in the closet somewhere and don't think about it. I'm just wondering what your thoughts are on that and what that's been like for you.
Yeah, same. My reality was busted open pretty early. And another thing John Mack identified, and I've heard many, many people say it since, is there's also a relationship with trauma and disassociation, where if you're able to take yourself out of your brain and sort of compartmentalize, I don't know why that was so hard to say, compartmentalize different aspects of what's going on, even in any given moment. I find myself as using this as a tool all the time. If I'm in a really boring meeting or listening to a really boring talk, just go somewhere else, sort of separate for a while. But I learned to do that at a pretty young age. And I also endured trauma at a young age that I think maybe helped facilitate that, or maybe even opened my mind to other things that allowed, you know, that moment like I described at the start of the show to happen, and then set a foundation for other weird things that I could be like, well, and I was forced to think about precognition a lot. And I came up with this theory to help explain to myself that my soul has lived in this body over and over. When I die, you know, that light at the end of the tunnel is coming out of my mom, starting it over, and then just doing it. Like, because I know the future. I see things. I knew my kids before I met them. I knew my wife before. I don't meet friends. I recognize my friends from these future times. So I was forced to try to think about how that could be. I've since changed that a little bit. That's not my worldview any longer. I don't necessarily think that's what happens when I die. But I had to start thinking about it. And Nietzsche has this quote that sometimes people don't want to hear or see the truth because they don't want their illusions destroyed. And I think that goes for all of us. And that's a big part of why the mainstream media won't touch this with a 10-foot pole, is they have to maintain these illusions for people. That's what the news has always been. You have a long, shitty day at work, you come home, well, at least everything's normal in the world. And so it gives you some comfort. You can go about your day, but then you have some of these experiences and that's gone. And now reality's bigger. And now you have to reconceptualize what it is and how you fit in it. And what's the relationship between this spiritual, energetic world and this physical world that we're inhabiting? And so I think a lot of people like you and I, even though we might fight it early on, at some point you got to give in. You're not dipping your toes in the water anymore. You're getting in, trying to figure out what's under the water. But the flip, I guess, so we'll call this the Jeffrey Kripal homage show because I'm bringing him up again. But he talks about this, but people just like me that were strict materialists, and then something happens and they flip. They have to look at the world in a different way. And I feel like I've been flipping over and over constantly since I was about 9 years old, kind of going back and forth between materialism and idealism in its different forms. I don't know. I think it's hard. Like I remember Bernardo Kastrup saying in an interview, maybe with Darren King, that he saw a UFO and he was like 5 or 6. And I was just like, nope, you're not supposed to be here. Filed it away, as didn't really see that. Doesn't matter, not thinking about it. And I think a lot of people do that as long as they can. And then at some point, you just can't do that anymore.
Absolutely. Something I find really fascinating about it is that when people do flip, and Jeffrey Kripal's book was instrumental in me trying to understand what happened to me when I flipped. So I'm definitely also a big fan. The way that you interact with the world starts to change. I think that there is something a little bit special about studying, you know, ufology and non-human intelligence, that it feels like there's something kind of alive in our community that's bringing us together. That's just the sense that I have personally. Yeah. But I also think that this isn't like necessarily particular to our field. And like you said before, like, I don't think of myself as being special for operating in that way, or like I have some kind of powers. I'm starting to really think of this as just the capacity of a human being when you're open to it. And I find so fascinating about our culture that when we don't, like, a big key to kind of unlocking these abilities and capacities seems to be just believing that you can, or like being open to the, not even believing, just being open to the idea seems to just crack the door just enough that all of this stuff comes rushing into your life that you never would have believed possible. And it started to look to me the ways in which we have been kind of trained to ignore those parts of being a human and to amputate those aspects of our experience has begun to look to me like its own kind of control mechanism. And I don't know if that's from some kind of non-human intelligence or if that's from, you know, humans and the power structure on this planet. Because it seems like what would happen if everyone all at once recognized that, like, those were abilities and capacities that we could have? Like, how would the world change? And I just wonder, I don't know, I guess I just wonder what you think about that idea.
Yeah. There's a lot to unpack there. I mean, people innately fear what they don't understand. And I know I did. When this really impactful moment happened in Phoenix that I've referenced a couple of times here, I was really messed up for like 3 or 4 weeks, depending on who you ask. In my family, they might give you a different number that's probably longer. But I was fearful of what reality is and how there can be people in my brain, or my consciousness can be controlled, or other people's consciousness can be completely controlled to the extent that they barely even remember being involved in things like that. And it just really shatters your understanding. And how much of that is some aspect of control, a way of sort of turning people on, saying, hey, wake up, wake up. The thing I talked about in that New York City conference, Inquiry into the Anomalous, that there was another event that happened probably about 7 or 8 months prior, just before I went to opening the archives at Rice, where I felt like I was having a telepathic communication moment. And I know that sounds insane. And obviously, you know, we associate things like that with schizophrenia and hearing voices in your head. I don't have that. And it's very different. Like, I can tell the difference when this is happening versus just my internal dialogue. And it's a very clear distinction, especially as it's happened more, it's become even more evident. But I didn't really pay attention to it. I wrote it off as just being in my head. And I almost wonder if that's partly why they showed up in physical form or brought physical people into it to be used in this way to say, hey, wait, look, that did happen. And they referenced a very specific thing that was said in that earlier telepathic conversation. And I was forced to be like, oh, that was real. Wow. That's interesting. And then from that point on, the way I think about things and do things is different. It's almost like a switch turns on. And when I talked about this with Jesse, and to a large extent in New York with the live audience and people who are watching online, because it was a hybrid event, so many people wrote to me saying the same type of thing, that there was this moment where they were sort of switched on. For some people, this was interesting. I heard this a number of times. It was too much. And it was really affecting their life. They couldn't deal with it. They didn't have that foundation that I'd mentioned I had been building since I was about 9. So it was too much. They asked for it to stop, and it did. And I mentioned in this talk that they were very polite to me. They asked for permission to do these things. They asked if I was okay with this. They asked if I had any questions. They asked if I needed anything. And these people who asked for it to stop, they honored that. They did stop it. And then at some point, one woman said, then I wanted it back, but I don't know how to get it back. And I felt really bad because she like turned it off, but then eventually got that foundation built, wanted to stay on the top of it, and wasn't able to figure out how to connect again in that way. So yeah, I think there's definitely something going on that does feel like a control mechanism. And I think it was at Valet that was first introducing that idea in like the 70s, maybe. The trickster element, I think, is a big part of it too, speaking of Valet. One thing that's interesting, I hadn't really thought about this before, but Rizwan Virk mentioned that maybe people, that it's not that you're special per se, like we were talking about. I don't feel special. I don't feel like I have any extra abilities. I've just been more open. I'm good at disassociation. I've had trauma that maybe helped with these things, opening me up. But he talks about it in the sense of like NPCs and RPGs, role-playing games, where there's certain characters who are doing things, or they're more a part of the game, and then ones that are kind of walking around that are programmed. And it's horrible to think of people like that, you know, you go to the store and half of the people are just there filling space that you're interacting with. But if we are in a video game, that's a very possible scenario that should be considered. I don't necessarily think we are. I don't know. Maybe nobody can know. We've had some conversations about this. I have been leaning more toward that as a possibility, or a simulation of some sort as a possibility, whereas I used to just write it off completely. So yeah, that's a very long non-answer to your question. I don't think I actually said anything there. Basically just exploring some thoughts I've had about it, but I don't know. I mean, it feels like, and if that conscious reality, source consciousness, if we're all just these little expressions of it in various capacities, little droplets of light or whatever, if that other thing is where we come from and where we go, it probably in control in some ways. It has the ability to control. I have seen that personally, and others have described this too. But what does that mean? What does that mean for our autonomy and for our free will and our agency? I don't know. And then that gets into an area that people don't like to talk about because they don't necessarily trust it, or they think it's demonic. And then we start ascribing all of these things that we think we know to a thing we don't know, to try to conceptualize it in a way that we can't understand and not fear it. But there's a lot of problems in doing that too. So I'll shut up now, because I'm really not answering your question at all.
No, I loved that answer. I thought it was wonderful. We're just going to take a quick commercial break and we'll be right back.
Have you ever read Communion? Or have you never read Communion? It's out in a new edition. Very powerful, a subtly new cover that reflects the fact that the visitors are now looking back at us, because they truly are. You can get it from the unknowncountry.com store, as a Kindle, as a beautiful, sumptuous paperback, or as an unabridged audiobook read by me. It's the first time in the whole life of Communion that it has been read in full in audio format, and believe you me, I felt that reading. I put my life, my memories into it, and I trust you can hear it in the voice. I sure felt it while I was reading. So get communion, listen to it, read it. Communion is of central importance to all of our lives.
Hi, everyone. This is Kelly Chase. I'm Dreamland's new monthly guest host. You can catch me here on the last Friday of every month. If you're interested in checking out my other work, you can find that on my podcast, The UFO Rabbit Hole. On that show, I share my own personal research with deep dives into everything from historical cases to philosophical frameworks, as well as in-depth interviews with top thinkers in the field, like Jeffrey Kripal, Diana Walsh-Pasulka, Bernardo Kastrup, James Madden, and of course, Dreamland's own Whitley Strieber. You can find the UFO Rabbit Hole on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, YouTube, or wherever else you listen to podcasts. Just search for the UFO Rabbit Hole. And if you like what you hear and you want to go even further down the rabbit hole with me, I'd like to invite you to join my Patreon community. Patrons get perks like early access to new content and ad-free episodes. I host twice monthly patron-only Zoom calls where you can ask me questions, share your own thoughts, and connect with others. We also have a lively and active private Discord server where members host book clubs, happy hours, and just share their thoughts on all things anomalous without all the drama that's all too common on social media. It's a warm, open-minded, and vibrant community, and we'd love to have you join us. Memberships start at just $5 a month. You can sign up at patreon.com/UFO rabbit hole. That's patreon.com/UFO rabbit hole. I actually really love that analogy of the NPC, because in some ways that's how I've conceptualized it in my own life. And, you know, obviously neither of us mean that, you know, there are certain people aren't fully human or that they aren't,
right.
You know,
yes. Fully that's an important
valuable.
Qualifier. Yes.
Yes, absolutely.
And Riz didn't mean that either. It's just kind of a way of thinking about it in the context of video game.
Oh, absolutely. And I think that it's something that I've thought of myself, because I think that as I've gone through my own process, I think I realized over time that, you know, I think we get really locked into these loops. You know, people are working these 9-to-5 jobs and, you know, they've got bills to pay and, you know, you're exhausted and you're stressed out and you get home and, you know, you dissociate for a while in front of the television and you go to bed and then you do it again. And I think that I recognized in myself that I sometimes went years, if not like a decade, without making a real decision, without, you know, really engaging with my life in that way. And I was actually on it won't be out probably for a couple of weeks, but I was recording an interview with this guy, Clint, who's got this really great new show, Night Shift, on YouTube. People should check it out. And he was like saying to me almost apologetically, you know, that he almost felt like a sleeper agent. He's like, you probably didn't feel that way. That probably sounds stupid. But I was like, no, I've used that exact terminology. And I've heard it from so many other people.
What's
and
the
there
term?
Does seem like a sleeper agent, you know, like somebody who is like kind of turned on. And
yeah.
And I've used that as well, because it feels something happened along the way that just fundamentally changed how I engaged with the world. And it changed how the world engaged with me.
Yeah.
And I just find that fascinating. So I actually really like that metaphor. I think it's great.
Yeah. Well, that's not my material. I'm channeling Riz here. I guess channeling is the wrong word, but I like that way of thinking about it too. And potentially we're all sleeper agents until we're not. I mean, who knows? I doubt anybody's really born just, you know, does anybody even ever reach enlightenment? I think we're all just kind of stumbling along trying to figure shit out. But yeah, I don't know. It does oftentimes take something to flip the switch on and get you out of that mode. Like yeah. The fun thought experiment, if anything else.
Yeah, I think that's what excites me most about to bring up the dreaded D word, disclosure.
I'm glad you went with that D word and not a different one. I didn't know where this conversation was
going. You're like, uh-oh. But, you know, as frustrating as that process can be and as frankly skeptical as I've become of it, not that I don't think that there are people involved who are like extraordinarily sincere, but I just wonder if this is the kind of thing that they're really going to allow to get out. But it seems like if just even a little bit of something could be taken a little bit more seriously in the public sphere, that might shake people enough, because it seems to have done that for a lot of people in the UFO community.
That's true.
And I would just love to see that on a larger scale. But I wonder about what your thoughts are on kind of the disclosure movement and where we are with all of that.
Well, I mean, in the context of what we're talking about with people sort of being switched on, I've had so many conversations with folks, some who I'm now collaborating on academic papers with. We've sort of formed this international group of scholars in Brazil, the UK, here in the US, who's from the UK. He's at Harvard now, but he's, it's funny because in meeting people and working collaboratively with them, a lot of them are new and they have an origin point. And for a lot of them, it's Heidi and Leslie and Ralph's 2017 article. For a lot of other people, it's more recently, it's been Grush testifying in front of Congress under oath. Importantly, like that was the thing that they were like, wait, he could go to prison if he's lying to them. So yeah, there's things that are happening that maybe are sort of turning some people on at different times slowly. Because if we all woke up to the reality of this, maybe that's the catastrophic disclosure people have been going on about more recently that we all want, obviously, because then boom, it's done. However, the flip side of that, I've heard a lot of people in this community say, is that they don't want to know what it is, because then they don't have this question that they're completely obsessed with to obsess over anymore. But I think that's pretty rare. I think we all do want to know what it is, how it's been interacting with it, how it's been shaping us potentially, how we may go into shaping it even as well. But yeah, I don't know. I feel like it's good. We're on a good trajectory. There's just hope now that I don't think existed before for actually knowing. I don't think we necessarily need the government for that. And that's where it gets tricky with disclosure. Are we talking about government disclosure or just knowing? Are they telling us? Are they leading government, which is what I think it is? And I've heard others say this as well, that the government, at least in the US and a couple other places, are struggling to keep up or catch up because they don't want to be left out there in right field with their hands in their pockets, like, oh, didn't see this coming. It almost, especially with the Schumer amendment, they almost seem like they're trying to get out ahead of something they know is coming. How do they know it's coming? Is it the visitors themselves that are putting those pieces of the puzzle together for them? I get the sense that whoever they is, when you said they aren't going to let this happen, I don't think they can stop it. I think we're too far along. And I think the forces that are actually leading this charge are the ones who have been interacting with us throughout antiquity.
Yeah, no, I think that's really interesting, especially kind of what you were alluding to with the urgency around it. And there's been this suggestion that they know something is coming. And given the work that you do, I'm sure you've heard these theories. I know Ross Coulthard at one point talked about it, that there was this, there are these kind of rumors, and who knows if it's disinformation or if there might be something to it, that future humans are actually a part, like that we know certain things that are coming because humans from the future have maybe come back and like alerted certain members of the intelligence community that those things are coming. Like, what do you make of those kinds of rumors and stories that kind of percolate at times?
Yeah, they do. And I've gotten to know some people, much like Ross, in the intelligence community or intelligence adjacent, who have said very similar things, but from different sources, from different people. So if you hear something enough, you kind of have to take it at least seriously consider it. You don't have to believe it. It's like I have this rule, or if I meet someone three times, I remember their name. I make an absolute point of remembering who they are, and oftentimes apologize for forgetting the previous two times, but I'm very bad with names. But if you hear this coming from all of these different places, different sources, maybe it's something to pay attention to. The question is, and I really go deep into this in my second book, toward the end of my second book, I think it was the 13th case study, maybe, with what would be the intention and how would that work with regard to perceived time paradoxes? Are they coming back to change something that they know is happening? Are there different timelines? Is there a war over timelines, which is one scenario that you hear about it about? Or are they trying to warn us about something that is coming in our shared timeline? Or, like we were talking about a little bit ago, is it possible to do slight modifications to the same timeline without violating causality in any way, which is absolutely on the table too, I think. So yeah, I believe that's important. The thing that was done to me on the fourth floor balcony in Phoenix was about something coming in the future. That indicates they know the future. Does that mean they're future humans? Maybe a extraterrestrial or interdimensional, although I kind of consider interdimensional and extratempestrial the same thing, just a different version that's more specific, because interdimensional doesn't actually say who they are. We throw that term around like it's an answer to the question. All it is a method of travel. Sorry, I'm a little bitter about how much that term's overused, despite saying absolutely nothing. There's definitely something there. They know what's coming. I felt some sense of urgency in the way it was done. I should point out for people that aren't familiar with this account that they told me I would have no access to the information. And they were right. I don't know what they put in my brain. I know it was three things that they said will be important at future times. So I think it's three different things for three different times. Told me I wouldn't know what it is and asked if I was okay with that very politely. And by this point in the conversation, it was very clear that I was interacting with something I'd been interacting with my entire life that is much bigger than me or any of us. So I agreed. It's in there somewhere, and it's in there for the future, whatever that future might be. I don't know. But you combine that one data point with all of these other ones from these different people, some of whom are in a position to know. And it's definitely food for thought.
Yeah, that was something I really resonated with in your experience, because that was something that happened to me as well, in that I was shown a lot of things, and I know that I was shown things from the future that were important, and I have no access to that.
Yeah, not yet.
And I have had the experience, though, of which will actually be in this shameless plug, second and third parts of my series about my own experience, which will be coming out later this summer. But I have had things that have triggered things that have made me remember what I saw. Like, it seems like there's almost like these activation, like you'll know it when you see it. And then, and
by the way,
fascinating.
Real quick, how insane is that? How crazy is that? That they can put things in our brains that are just chilling, minding their own business, and all of a sudden, bam. You're out. It's your time. You know, we're opening the gates. The starter gun went off. How does that even work? It's so insane to think about. I don't know. There's another, actually, it might have been chapter 6 in John Mack's book, Abduction. Same thing. He was told this will be important for the future. You won't remember it until it's time. And then here it comes. It just shows us how much we don't understand about not just consciousness, but brain physiology too, because it's in there. I physically felt it going into my brain, and I had a strong response to it too. I cried uncontrollably the next day, not because of that moment, but because of whatever they did to the physiology of my brain. It's just, I don't know. It's mind blowing if you kind of just step back. Like, it's a crazy story to start with, but then you step back and you're like, wait, how the hell did they do that? That is insane. I don't know.
Yeah. And I had the same experience of crying uncontrollably afterwards. When I have my kind of dark nights of the soul, I mean, I think that there are people at this point who maybe think I'm too credulous, or who think that I've like completely gone off the deep end. And I mean, trust me, nobody's considered the idea that I might be going crazy like more frequently than I have. I have this ever increasing fear that I'm just like getting too weird.
Well. Yeah, it's good to have filters in place, though. And man, I apparently listened to your show more than I realized. But when you were talking to Dean Radin in a recent episode, I was really glad he spoke to that, because we have to have those. You have to have filters in place. You have to say, no, I don't want this right now, or this is too much. And you pull back, you ground yourself in reality. Meditation helps. Having a family helps. Having friends who don't know anything about what you do helps. There's definitely things you can do to erect those filters and buffer yourself. And I think we need to, especially when things like this are happening, because it would be easy to just go down a path and end up in a loony bin. But there are definitely ways to avoid that. And I'm sure you're doing those things as well.
Yeah. You know, I do my best to not go crazy. I think a lot of it is just always kind of, there's always at least like 25% of my brain that's skeptical about everything because of
that's
the fact.
That's helpful too. Yeah.
Well, and because of the fact that something I feel came along and like messed with my brain and changed my personality. And so it's hard not to be skeptical even of yourself and what you think you know when something like that happens, you know?
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, this looks like a good place for us to leave off on the unpaid portion of the program. I'm going to be continuing on for paid members with Mike for about another 30 minutes. And we're going to be talking about some really interesting stuff. I'm going to have a few more questions about the experience that Mike had in Arizona and some other really interesting topics. So if you aren't a member of Dreamland, I hope that you'll consider joining. And it was wonderful spending time with all of you. And we hope we'll see you again soon.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.